Hello, hello, everybody. It is 4 p.m. Central Time on Wednesday, the 12th of July, 2017. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap the seismic events that strike around the planet. And we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. So if you're new here, you're looking at a globe that shows us the past 48 hours worth of activity, and the deeper earthquakes are raised high off the globe so you can see them easily. So right off the bat, we need to talk about something that just developed in the last hour here in the West Pacific near Japan. There was a 5.8, 5.9 very deep earthquake, 537 kilometers deep, down below the Sea of Japan. Technically, I think, in North Korean waters. Now, this area is very, very interesting because of a few things that have happened here in the past and that just happened over the past day and a half. So what's happened in the past here? Well, to see what's happened in the past here, I'm going to turn on a display capture and we'll go over to Google Earth. And we'll come all the way over here and we'll put our coordinates in for the earthquake. And these coordinates, let's get them from... we'll get them from the EMSC. They have it at 5.9. USGS has it at 5.8. Either or, several of the stations going up above 6.0. So we'll put the coordinates in here, take out the semicolon, and hit search. Now, of course, we're coming in Sea of Japan, western portion of Sea of Japan right here by an undersea mount, and we're at 537 kilometers down below all of this, but 140-something miles over to the west. Let's get the exact miles on this. 143 miles over to the west in kilometers. That's 230 kilometers to the west is our previous underground hydrogen bomb blast test. They said it was a small hydrogen bomb that they detonated here. Now, I don't know what exactly they detonated, but that was the previous test site. So we're 100 miles, basically, 100 and something miles from the nuclear test site. That's close enough, I would say. Look, it's suspicious, but the depth on this, there's no way they could have gotten this down that far, you know, for an underground test. Now, what also could be the cause of this earthquake if it wasn't a nuclear test? Well, take a look at what happened yesterday next to it, a deep 5 at 340 kilometers deep. Now, we were looking for a 6.0 type earthquake to strike here. Right here. Okay, so see where we are on the coast of Japan? And it struck just due west of there. The exact magnitude we were looking for, not in the location, and the depth is a little bit strange on this. It's deeper than the previous day's deep 5.0. So we have big time deep movement happening here down below Japan. And that means there's the potential of shallower, larger movement coming this week. Within the next 7 days from these deep earthquakes. Now, today is day one, and there's a new deep 5.9 following yesterday's deep 5. So yesterday's deep 5 already put us on a warning, but now we really have to be on watch. Where? We have to watch the silent zones in between the current sets of earthquakes, and we have to watch downstream from these events. What's downstream? Well, look which way the arrows point. There's two different directions the pressure is going to go. One way to the east, the other to the west. And it's already started to push to the west with a new 4.7 to 5.0 striking south of Mongolia at the Craton Edge in Asia going into the Himalayan range. We were expecting some activity to go over to the west, but it's going to be bigger. So with this kind of activity, again, around Japan, 1 to 2 magnitude larger is possible. 1 to 2 magnitude larger. So I don't have to, this is not an exaggeration. Go back to last year in October when the deep 5.8 at this depth struck over here in Italy in the Tyrrhenian Sea. We issued a warning. The next day, the shallower, larger earthquake struck next to the deep earthquake. So that kind of narrows down our area. So if you're living in Japan, if you're living to the west over here in China, look, you got a big deep earthquake down below you. Okay, this is a good way to look at this. Look at this. Whoops. One second. Sorry, guys. Hold on. Well, this isn't working. Something just happened to my Earthquake 3D. Okay, that's crazy. What I'm trying to show you here is a sphere option that's just not working, so we'll turn it on a different way. Looking on the shell, okay, the shell will show us an angle of, again, affected area coming out from the earthquake. So I want you to imagine this shell far down below the plate. And maybe now I can get this to work. There we go. Now it works for some reason. So looking at this in a sphere, I want you to imagine this down below the plate, pushing up on the underside of Japan and Korea, going up to Kamchatka Peninsula, and going down to Taiwan. And all perimeters on all sides of this are going to move. And they're going to move on a greater level, at least one magnitude larger. Luckily, we've got plate boundaries in here. They're going to dictate where the pressure goes to. It's not just going to randomly come up anywhere out in here. In between here, we have fractures that go all the way down through the crust, down to the asthenosphere. So you get pressure coming up from down below, it pushes up above, and it's going to move the plate boundaries, which then reduces our areas to watch, where there aren't any earthquakes along the plate boundaries on the perimeter of this big, deep event, right? So you can see where it goes to. So if you live down from Taiwan going up to South Japan, and if you live from Hokkaido going all the way up to Kamchatka, I would watch. If you live along the Izu Ridge, where the perimeter goes out to, you have to keep watch, and it's big enough that it could cause, you know, an effect for the whole area. All right, so now that you've seen that, that's just the biggest, deepest earthquake of the day. That's not all that struck. We saw other activity strike down here south of New Zealand, a new 5.0, and the central part of New Zealand flaring up with new activity. Look, so threes going all the way across in all of our expected locations. The only thing that hasn't happened yet is a new earthquake striking up here to the north at the Kermadec. That's the only thing we're waiting for at this point. So it should happen soon, maybe the next day. Okay, now, well, let's talk about the United States before we get into Europe. Look at what happened last night. If you were not tuned in last night, you'll just be shocked to hear what happened. Last night, I addressed Professor John Vidali, one of my biggest critics, coming from the Northwest. He was residing up here in Washington State, professor at the University of Washington State. He took to social media, came to my pages, said all kinds of horrible things about me, issued press releases about me. He came to my Facebook page yesterday, and we got into a little debate back and forth, and I told him to tune in last night at 10 p.m., and I'd be addressing the Northwest and addressing how pressure transfers across the plate. As I was talking about it last night, while I was addressing Professor John Vidali, a 4.1 noteworthy earthquake popped up right in the zone we were talking about where pressure comes out from. Now, when it struck, I was incredulous. I just couldn't believe it. I literally thought that maybe John Vidali was messing with me and just throwing an earthquake on the feed to mess with us. That's what I thought, and I had a right to think that since he runs the network or ran the network for reporting the earthquakes up here. And as I'm talking about him and 4.0 and 5.0 earthquakes, then a 4.0 earthquake strikes out there, again, I get a little suspect. I have a right to, since the guy's criticizing me, and he ran the network. I don't know if he still does, but he did up until last year. And so, again, an earthquake striking out here right in the middle of the zone that we were watching. What's going on here? Well, of course, a 4.1 means, on its own, it's enough to push all the way to the interior portion of the plate, maintain momentum all the way over to the Midwest, and that's kind of what's happening right now. Look at the largest earthquake of the day aside from the 4.1. See that? See this 3.4? Wait till you see where it struck. We'll get our coordinates from the USGS just because I don't think people are going to believe this. This is the ultimate irony. So last night, while I was addressing John Vidali, my biggest critic, an earthquake struck right in his backyard, right in the spot where he hadn't seen any activity in weeks. Now, today, a new earthquake has struck downstream, as expected, about a half magnitude less, at Arizona's border. Wait till you see what's there. Wait till you see what's there. You're not going to believe it. It's almost like there's some kind of synchronicity going on here, or God's on my side or something. Look where the earthquake just struck, guys. Next to Dutchman's Draw Volcanic Butte. Right next to Dutchman's Draw, a new 3.4. Right here. Dutchman's Draw. I mean, of all the volcanoes on the freaking plate, it happens there? That is even more weird. I'm starting to get, you know, first, I'm wondering, it's at 13.3 kilometers depth. Let's look at our stations and just see what they reported here. Okay, a range of threes going up to mid-range three on one set. And going up to four on another. All right, I mean, look at all the stations reporting. So they're not faking it. If they are, then it's just the weirdest thing in the world. All right, I mean, I just can't believe it. But there it is. So an earthquake, the largest striking downstream, east-southeast, at Dutchman's Draw, following the 4.1 yesterday. Now that's going to carry on over to the east, and we should see new mid-range 3 to 4.0 activity striking back at the fracking operations at Oklahoma-Kansas border. Since it's coming down this far, I'm going to have to say watch western Oklahoma and central Oklahoma. This could include the Kansas border, but I mean, you can see where I'm zooming in here, right? So watch there, since the pressure's coming down the coast a little bit. Also, Southern California, you're going to get hit by near 4.0 activity. It might come in just a few points less, but it's coming from that 4 that just struck off the coast last night. Now let's look at the smaller earthquakes really quick. Let's look at the 0.0 and greater. These are our microquakes. So these are very small earthquakes compared to our 3s and 4s. And let's turn down our rings just to get a better idea what's going on. Now what you're going to see here is a new swarm has popped up at Yellowstone in the past 24 hours. I don't think anybody should be shocked by that. A new 4.0 has struck over here off the coast. So a new 4 here pushes over to the east and southeast, and it's causing a new swarm of microquakes to break out at Yellowstone, and that is an increase. Additionally, down to the south a little activity, down more near Jackson Hole. So that's really interesting, kind of at the southern edge of what we would call the Yellowstone Park before you get into the park itself. And then, of course, the swarm up in Montana is carrying on, and that's to be expected since you got the largest earthquake in 40 years there at the northern edge of the magma chamber for Yellowstone. The magma chamber for Yellowstone is 11 Grand Canyons in size, measured as of a year and a half ago, and it extends up into Montana, over into Idaho, almost all the way over to the Oregon border. Now, this brings me into Oregon. This brings me into Washington State. Both of which were showing activity yesterday pretty heavy, and today it's a drop-off. Look, up to the north and central dropped off completely. So there was a swarm at Rainier yesterday, it stopped. There was a swarm at or around Mount St. Helens yesterday, it stopped. There was a swarm just east of Glacier Peak, it stopped. And instead we just have a couple microquakes, that's it. So that's a noteworthy decrease, right? Well, look what just happened. Pressure was slightly relieved off the coast with a new 4.0 now pushing down to the east-southeast, causing that 3.4 and causing the swarm at Yellowstone. But the earthquakes that caused all this have stopped. Now, I would like to also open up the slow slip real-time tremor map. And this is going to show us all of our microquakes or small tremors. These are below microquakes. They're just the result of plate movement side by side. In other words, plates are butting up against each other, and then we see these small events indicating that there's a little bit of slippage passing in each zone. Now, this is the last 48 hours. Take a look at it. Yesterday, we had our cluster starting up here to the north at Vancouver Island. Today, look what happened. It stopped up to the north and center. It literally did. There's only a couple. What, three? Three to the north, maybe four, but down to the south, look what's picking up. A new cluster down at Redding. So up to the north it went for a day, now down to the south it's going for the day. Is it going to carry on? Well, we have a cluster at Redding and another cluster over next to Eureka. Two clusters of tremors indicate something going on. Let's show you what's offshore. So let's show you here what's on land. First of all, Redding, California. Let's turn off our photos. Those are kind of getting in the way. So we get here. Okay, here's Redding, California. And then you go over to the west and you get right over here past Hay Fork, and we go on to Ferndale, Eureka, and right off the coast, look what's off the coast. The Gorda Escarpment and Mendocino Ridge. So the southern tip of this is now under pressure and it's re-exciting things back up slow slip-wise at the tip of the plate. But there's, again, a 4.1 out here. Pretty much, oh, you know what? Hold on. You know what? Hold on. Let's go look up this 4.1. Let's actually mark it because I think it might be falling on a volcanic field itself. Hold on. Didn't even think to do this. We'll do it real time for you guys. Yep. Parks Seamount and the East Blanco Depression. The East Blanco Depression, the EBD, is a pull-apart basin within the Western Blanco Transform Fault Zone, a right lateral transform fault that links the Juan de Fuca Ridge and Gorda Ridge, and that's a reference from 1996. In January 1994, a T-wave swarm suggested eruptive activity. Investigations later that year were inconclusive regarding the associated eruption, but found an active hydrothermal mound on the flanks of a pillow lava volcano. Recent seafloor eruptions as of 96. Okay, well, we have an earthquake striking right in here, and I've shown this before. There's so many undersea volcanoes here, it's not even funny. I mean, they're scattered all throughout here. You can see some of them with the undersea sonar imagery, but, I mean, for every one that you can see, there's so many more if you zoom in even closer, even smaller ones that are a couple hundred to a few thousand feet high. So, all right, so we have a earthquake striking out there, and the slow slip is stopping on land, picking up to the south. And this leads me down into California, which we warned you yesterday would be getting hit in the next couple days with the new 4.0 type earthquake down to the south due to this new fort. Well, in between there, there's going to be an excitement, and that's already occurring. I'm going to name the areas for you. You're welcome to go check them out if you don't know about them, starting with the cluster up here in north California. So this is Clear Lake Volcano and the Geysers. Clear Lake Volcano and the Geysers. That's a volcano, obviously, but it's also being drilled into by humans that are steaming off water to turn steam turbines. Up here north of West and South Butte Volcano, we have a pumping operation in North Sacramento Valley. I've shown that many times in past videos. Going over to the east, we're right next to the Buttes Butte Volcano and Sugarloaf Butte Volcano. Then we have a new addition on the list, Pyramid Lake, at the Pyramid Lake Geyser Field on the shores of Pyramid Lake, where there's multiple small volcanoes. Then going down to the south, we've switched our location from central Lake Tahoe to the north shores of Lake Tahoe, and I believe that's related to water weight, and it's only zeros and ones that are striking. Going further down, we get two new clusters, one at Aurora Crater and Aurora Peak. Aurora Crater is obviously, by its name, you can understand it's a volcano. Further down to the south, we have Mammoth Mountain, Mammoth Lakes, and North Long Valley at Caldera, all three now swarming. Bigger cluster at Mammoth Mountain, smaller cluster at North Long Valley Caldera. Then going further down to the east-southeast, our nuclear test sites back at Doomtown and Pahrump. Yes, they call it Doomtown. It was the famous 1950s town that was built and then blown away with a nuke to test what would happen. So let me just show that to you here. We get swarms happening here whenever pressure is absorbing into California like a sponge. So here's the test sites themselves, all these craters. And each one of these craters, if you turn on the Google Earth community, you can read a little bit more. I don't want to waste too much of your time here. But you can see the kiloton detonations with each one. You can see the name of the operation. People have taken a long time to post all this. And Doomtown is right here, the actual town they built that they vaporized off. And that's being hit by a swarm of earthquakes. Now, again, it's not anything to panic over. It's just a sign that pressure is inundating all of California and Nevada. Now the 3.4 back over at Dutchman's Draw, and then back down to Southern California, where we're looking for a 4.0 to strike in the LA Basin down to Salton Sea. So that's a few hundred mile stretch there that we're watching. Subsequently, downstream from all that, we're watching the Midwest for a new swarm going up into the upper three near 4.0 level at Oklahoma, and then back up the East Coast. We'll probably see another 3.0 earthquake striking up here, more like near Maine this time. So last it was in New York. I think this time it's going to be in Maine because pressure's transferring to the east-northeast overall. Now this leads me into Europe. It's kind of pointing out that direction. It brings us across the Atlantic. And you can see the Azores were hit by a new 3.4. Well, I don't think anybody should be shocked by that because the Azores are a sign of pressure transferring across the Atlantic from Europe. The previous activity the day before, 4.0 level, now has gone down to a 3.0 level, losing a little momentum as it comes up and around through Portugal and striking back out at the letter X at the Azores. So that took place. That 3.4 is a result of the force yesterday down at Gibraltar. And look what happened today back in Europe. For my European viewers, we told you this was going to start to happen. Macedonia is back to swarming, and it went up into the mid-range 3, also down to the south, down here at Greece, swarming, but it's only in the 3 ranged as well. However, that's two swarms of 3s happening here. We have an influx of pressure coming in. Where is it coming in from? It's coming in from Turkey. So there's been a previous several days of 3s and a couple 4s that has now reached its block point here. That's why we're getting new clusters. This is probably going to be going back up in the 5 range in the next day. So if you're in Macedonia, in North Greece, I want you to be on watch for 5.0 activity to be striking Macedonia into Greece. It's a small stretch right here. Okay, let me turn down the rings. So you see where Macedonia is, and that's the border of Greece. So it's a pretty tiny little area right in here. So it could go up to 5. Secondly, over here in Italy, let's open up the INGV Italian list. This is the last 150 earthquakes reported by the INGV. To my Italian viewers, tanto amore, you've only been hit by a few earthquakes going up above 3 this week. That's good. There was the 4 last week, that fulfilled the previous movement, but look at it. Last 150 earthquakes tells the tale of where most of the activity in Italy is striking. I don't think I even need to show you. I mean, I do need to show you, but I don't even need to say anything about it. There it is. It looks like a skyscraper of earthquakes spread out across maybe 150 to 200 miles. This is the spot we're watching. Doesn't take a rocket scientist. From here to the north. And look what's happened. From here to the north, look at our clusters. From here to the south, it's kind of died out. Just a few. And they're all zeros and ones down to the south. Up to the north, 2s and near 3s. So you see that? Obviously, it's picking up center to north. Why is central Italy and north Italy picking up? Well, we told you, pressure's coming up out of Macedonia, coming across the Adriatic, and going up into central to north Italy. And the bigger the earthquakes are in Macedonia, the bigger the earthquakes are going to be up in central and north Italy going into Switzerland. It's why Switzerland was hit by a 4.5 this past week, if you add in CERN, which isn't a whole nother topic we could talk about. So Italy, what are you watching for? Well, you're watching for Macedonia to get hit by a 5. Once Macedonia gets hit by a 5, a new swarm will occur. You'll go back up again. There'll be another 4, and there'll be another swarm of 0s, 1s, 2s, and 3s. That's what's going to happen. That's what's been happening every day. Now, the reason The reason it's been happening every other day is, again, Macedonia and Greece and Turkey, they are directing the flow of pressure. So normally, in a normal scenario, pressure would come out of Turkey, go down around Crete, and come back up into Italy and dead end into Torino, causing small swarms of earthquakes just on a normal day, on a normal given day. But over the past couple months specifically, we saw a swarm break out here, right at the Turkey-Greece border across the Aegean Sea. And that redirected the flow of pressure going up to the northwest. Instead of going down and around Crete, where we were seeing all of our previous earthquakes, only a few earthquakes are going down and around Crete right now. Instead, they're going up to the west-northwest and striking back in central Italy to north Italy into Switzerland. Switzerland, like I said, with the largest earthquake in years, 4.5 striking there, it's no shock. So where do you watch overall? If you're in Macedonia, if you're in Greece, if you're in Italy, if you want to know what's coming your way, you have to look to Turkey, Iran, and the Middle East, going to Asia. If you see a bunch of 4s like this, you know these are going to add up and come in to Europe. Now, one other thing I would like to show you is the obvious progression of earthquakes coming out from the Pacific, where we have our deep earthquakes here. See our deep earthquakes? The deep earthquakes pushed all the way across Asia, Middle East, Europe, Mediterranean. And then they lost a little momentum and went out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, which you don't even see here because they're, again, a couple days old. We've only got the EMSC last 50 earthquakes showing. So I hope you understand, pressure transfers across the plate and you can see it coming your way. Speaking of seeing it coming your way, Now that we have new deep earthquakes like this, I want you to have an earthquake plan in the West Pacific that goes up above 6.5 to 7.5. I know, it's a big deal. So these deep earthquakes, look where they are. It's almost like a triangulation of deep occurrences. And you look in between the deep earthquakes, and that's where you're going to see your shallower, larger movement. So it kind of nails it down a little bit further when you see there's deep earthquakes on three sides of the West Pacific, and in between there is where we should see our big activity. Now, several of the locations we named last night were hit, okay, and the day before too. So we've checked off several of the locations over and over again, and now we have new locations in between our locations. So this is where it's going to get pretty busy. This is where things are going to really pick up. Now that we have earthquakes striking in 48 hours across the whole West Pacific, the fill-in points in between these spots are going to be filled in with larger activity, larger than what we have now. So if you see fours and a few fives, you'll see fives and a few sixes. It's that simple in the next several days. Down in New Zealand, you have your 6.8 to your south and nothing to your north. I'd watch to your north up in the Kermadecs. Watch out from the catcher's mitt position of North New Zealand at the north tip of the North Island to the Kermadecs. It would be prudent to watch that. I mean, if nothing hits, you'll be lucky, quite frankly. The chances are something's going to hit there because there's equal movement on both sides. Now, speaking of equal movement on both sides, this leads me into South America. Look at what hit in South America since last night. At the tips of both of our arrows, yesterday and today, 5.3 on one side up at the Ecuador-Colombia border and a 5.5 to the south. Within just a few points of each other and within a day of each other, where did these come from? These came from our deep four over here. Let me get that back on the screen. Where is it? Here we go. So raised high off the globe, deep 4.6 and a deep 4.7. Pushed over and caused a shallow 5.3 and a 5.5. Now, also since then, there's been subsequent fours striking at the same areas. So subsequent fours, that's following the fives, that's no shock. I would like to quickly go check the volcanic eruption feed and see if there's anything standing out as significant today. Sabancaya, Reventador, Turrialba, Dukono, Kerensky, Kluchevskoy, Kerensky. A couple of these are cancellations. And this gets down to yesterday. All right. Well, okay, let's go show you where these are. We'll start over here. First of all, Central America. Turrialba being the only one erupting right now. This is in Costa Rica. That follows Fuego actually blasting off. And Popo, Catepetl, also blasting off in Mexico. So Mexico and Guatemala blasting off with several large blast that stopped, now replaced by one here. Going down to the south, right next to our earthquakes is Reventador volcano right here. So I'm not shocked to see new eruptions also accompanying these larger earthquakes. Going down to the south even further, we have Sabancaya here where the letter V is. Well, there's no earthquakes there, but there's new blasts. And then finally we get back down to South America where Copahue was erupting but stopped. And once Copahue stopped erupting, that's when the fives hit. So South America, you have to look in between your volcanoes and between your earthquakes to understand what's coming your way. And when you look at it, you see obviously you've got a volcano right in the middle here at Turrialba. It's erupting. Well, that means next to Turrialba, there's going to be new 5.0 activity in the next day to 2 days. A new 5 is going to strike near Costa Rica very soon as a result of this deformation on the plate boundary. It should strike in the ocean or very close to it. All right, and then down to the south, we have another spot to watch. That's between the earthquakes here and the volcano, and down to the south where Sabancaya volcano is. And that brings us back into central Peru. Watch for a combined total between the eruptions to the north and the eruptions to the south. That puts us at a mid-range 5, topping out mid-range 5 in Peru in the next day and a half, maybe 2 days. Further down to the south, we can expect a new 5.0 earthquake to strike the South Sandwich Islands yet once again as a result of this previous 5. So it's going to travel down around and underneath and cause a new 5. So this 5 here will cause a new 5 down here. it doesn't really matter. I don't think there's that many people there. I really don't think there's anybody there. It's north of Antarctica. Also, just in general, I want you to watch out for a greater increase to occur with the solar activity that's happening. That can increase things globally. So it's a lot going on right now. Solar activity was on the increase with flares. We also saw an increase with the CERN activity that's been causing, I think, a little bit of a trouble, especially over in Europe. And we've also seen the deep earthquake event carry on, which itself causes shallower, larger earthquakes. So today's update is pretty brief. It's 30 minutes long. It's just a brief recap of the areas that we're watching. A new forecast will be out tomorrow for the next 72 hours. Since we were able to get on last night and yesterday and do an update and tell people where to watch, that still applies for the next couple days. I don't see anything too far out of the ordinary other than this new deep event down below the Sea of Japan. That one really is bothering me. I'm watching. We got a lot of viewers over in Japan. Got a lot of viewers downstream from this over to the west in Nepal. And I don't know if we have very many in China, but I know I've got a lot of viewers in Nepal and India. And guys, look, a deep earthquake here can affect you. It can. Look, the Nepal megaquake, the one that moved Mount Everest, just a couple days, I want to say it was two days before that, there was a deep earthquake pretty much right here in the Sea of Japan. But it was just a deep 5. Well, now we have a deep 5.9 and a deep 5 up in the Sea of Okhotsk. Well, those two alone are enough to put pressure over to the west and push the Himalayan range. Where does the Himalayan range butt into? It butts into Nepal, it butts into India, it butts into Myanmar, and it butts into Afghanistan, Pakistan. That's where it goes. So if you see pressure start to transfer across China, and you may see, I'm going to say may because this isn't a, we don't have a connecting arrow there. In other words, this is a rare occurrence. We don't normally see this happen. So this would be outside of the realm of normal earthquake forecasting. But we would look to the west across this range, and we would look to the middle point for the spot to be hit, just like all the others. Now, if it doesn't hit, don't fault me, because again, this is not something I would normally forecast for. I would definitely forecast around Japan for the shallower, larger movement to potentially show up in this next week. 7 days from today, that's how long we have to give it for the deep earthquakes, up to 7 days. We've seen it take, actually, we've even seen it take longer. We've seen it take 10 days for it to occur. But usually, I don't want you to have to watch for more than a week. So I'm going to tell you to watch for a week. If it doesn't hit within that week, I will be back on, and we will talk about where the energy went from this. It's not, energy is not just going to disappear. Now, there is a possibility for the cause of this quake. One possibility, or there's a couple possibilities. One, the nuke test that happened previously fractured a fault zone, which then primed it and got it ready. Then a new deep 5 happens here down below, pushes up on the fractured fault from their previous hydrogen bomb test, and causes a deeper earthquake to go split down further into the asthenosphere. Well, if that's the case, then it will cause a shallower, larger earthquake, if that's what's happening. The second possibility, it's more remote, but it is possible, is that there's a bunch of naval forces out here, out in the Sea of Japan, monitoring, watching, waiting for them to do some kind of test, in which case there's a VLF communication that's going on from facilities like HARP, up in Alaska, let's say, HARP up in Alaska, that can send high-frequency radio waves up into the ionosphere to create plasma up in the upper reaches of the ionosphere. That plasma then emits and resonates VLF, very low frequency. They can target that and send it down to talk to submarines down deep down in the ocean, also to communicate with ships. And unfortunately, when that VLF comes down to ground, there's something called efficiency scaling that happens, where the VLF, once it goes down and hits the crust or near the crust down at the seafloor, it can actually convert back into DC energy, actual electricity. And that's taken to ground via the magnetic field lines of the Earth that goes down into the crust, and then that goes down even further, down into the asthenosphere, building up piezoelectric charge into the rock, and then that can cause an earthquake far down below. So there's a VLF energy transference that could happen with naval forces, there's nuclear tests that happened nearby that could have fractured the fault, and there's a deep earthquake that happened to the north that could also be a culprit on this. So we have, you know, multiple possible causes for this new deep earthquake. Another possible cause would be solar events, with the new solar flares happening that, you know, could be accentuating things and causing something to happen far down below the plate. There's also an undersea mount next to it. What is this, five different possible causes? There's an undersea seamount next to the location that's also, you know, a little bit suspect. So you get in here. Whoops, let me bring this in normal north. There we go. And there is an undersea mount right next to it called the Coldso Seamount. Well, that's no doubt about it, volcanic in nature. Now, they don't have great undersea imagery on it, but you don't get an undersea mount that size in between these areas and not have it be a volcano. So, I mean, there could be several causes for it, but ultimately, we have to look for it to have an effect, that this earthquake, this deep earthquake over here, will be the new effect causer for the next several days. So it will definitely cause new, shallower, larger earthquakes around the plate. This is big enough to push the whole planet, quite frankly. Something this size at that depth to push the whole Pacific plate. So that's why I want you to have a plan. And does your earthquake plan encompass, if you're on the coast, do you have a tsunami plan? Over here, where the 4.1 hit, as part of the ongoing slow slip event that's happening on the west coast of the United States, you have to have a plan for an earthquake that goes above 7.7, in my opinion. If I lived there, I would have an earthquake plan that definitely covered above 7.7. I would also have, if I lived along the coast, I would have an evacuation plan that I've already either planned out or actually physically taken the steps to do, where I've driven in my car and figured out how long it takes me to get uphill and know my altitude, know my elevation, so that, again, I know where to go if a wave is coming in. Now, a wave would only be generated if a very, very large earthquake struck out here off the coast. And unfortunately, 7.7 earthquakes and greater are big enough to cause some wave activity. And that's what I'm worried about. I'm worried about the potential of a large earthquake striking out here as a result of the slow slip. As soon as the slow slip finally stops for a few days, we're going to issue a warning for the area. Until it stops for a few days, we're going to consider it carrying on. And if the slow slip is carrying on, then that's delaying the pressure release. It's buying a rain check for the pressure release. It's kind of just kind of dragging it on, if you will. So we're watching and watching and waiting and waiting. And if nothing happens, I'll be the first to get back on here and say, look, the slow slip finally stopped completely, and there hasn't been any follow-up movement. But the chance of nothing happening after 4 or 5 months worth of slow slipping is pretty slim, in my opinion. So take it for what it is. It's my educated opinion. Again, educated based upon watching for 8 years and seeing this happen in the past. So we've seen past events lead up to large earthquakes during these slow slips. Japan, Vancouver, Mexico, New Zealand, several of the locations. Now, the earthquake plan is a little bit different. This earthquake plan that I'm talking about doesn't require you to buy a bunch of supplies. It doesn't require you to have a bunch of water and guns. It means that you need to just have a place to go when the earthquake is actually hitting that can protect your body and head. Because what good are you if you're knocked out or bleeding or injured? And that could be averted very simply by having a sturdy structure to get underneath, whether that's a desk or a table or something that you buy and build. It would be some way to protect yourself from falling drywall, plaster, things that are on the walls. And then while you're underneath that structure, waiting, listening, you're basically paying attention to what's happening to your house around you. And if it sounds like there's going to be a structure collapse, or you start hearing structure collapse, you are then making your way out the door. And you know which door you're going to. You know where you're going when you get outside, and you know what's outside, so that you're not playing dodgeball with falling materials, falling antennas, falling shingles, falling glass. If you're in a city, God knows what's up above you. So guys, you need to just plan that. Have a plan for it. Now, I'm talking to the people in the zones that we're warning. We're not talking to the people out here in the middle of nowhere. No offense. No offense, okay, but we're not talking to you guys. We are telling you maybe you might want to just have a plan. Just think about it. But really, for the people who live in the areas on the West Coast or in the Midwest, where fours can take down chimneys and knock down facades off houses, we saw a 4.3 strike in Oklahoma at the start of 2016, last year, that took down chimneys and knocked facades off houses. A 4.3. So that's, again, why I want you to be prepared. Because if that hits in the middle of the night and you got a chimney falling through your roof, you need to have a plan about what you're going to do to take care of that. And not only that, how you're going to protect yourself, assuming where your chimneys are or your facades on your houses are. Okay, so that's all I've got for you. Today's update, pretty short. I'm going to go ahead and save this as a video on my channel, and we will also replay this tonight at 10 p.m. Central Time, I think. I'll try to. And if anything else goes down between now and then, I will be back on to report at a moment's notice. What's going on? Oh, somebody else reporting, okay, the previous earthquake. Okay, so yeah, word up to my people. Thank you to everybody who supported my operation, everybody who tuned in last night. We really got a treat from some supernatural force somewhere. That was wild. The fact that a 4.1 earthquake struck off the coast of Oregon while I was addressing Professor John Vidali about 4 and 5.0 earthquakes off the west coast of Oregon, causing earthquakes downstream. Now today, Dutchman's Draw gets hit downstream. It's almost like there's some kind of supernatural force involved, or Anonymous is on my side. I'm leaning towards the former as opposed to the latter. It's a sad day when you're going to believe in a miracle over Anonymous. Okay. Anyways, how many people are in here right now? About 700 people? Okay, good. That's enough people. I do have to ask you. I don't have any marketing networks behind me. I'm not in any multi-channel group with YouTube. I have to ask you to subscribe to my channel firsthand. So please subscribe if you like my work. And if you really like my work, you can give on a monthly basis or one time on Patreon, which is a way for people to give for my work. It's not like a fundraiser for my future operations. It's a giving for what I'm doing right now. So if you like what I do, reporting on earthquakes, or earthquake forecasting, or weather reporting, or HARP, or any of the other stuff that I do, you're welcome to contribute, and the link is down below. Apparently, what I'm doing is really bothering the professionals, because a professional has showed up on my Facebook page, Professor John Vidali, and another professional is making videos. He's a guy from the American Geophysical Union, or at least claimed to be from there, and they're really upset about my Patreon. Oh yeah, they're trying to shut down my Patreon. So if you like, and this is them, we need to shut down his Patreon. Hey, how many people are in here now? 666 people. Perfect amount of people to come in here. That's great. Oh my God. All right, guys. So for the people who have attacked me on my Patreon, that number is for you. All right, that is for you. For the people who are supporting me on my Patreon, much love for all of you. You guys have made it so I don't have to have sponsors, so that if YouTube shuts me down, I'm still set and can keep doing this, and so that I don't have to run ultimate ads. I can keep it down to a minimum. Hopefully you guys are getting minimum ads on here. They're not popping up all the time. It just makes it so I can do what I want to do without being beholden to anybody in particular. And that's great. So thank you to all of you who've contributed. I will be back on if anything else goes down. Word up. Peace out.